bit more.
I don't always use RxJS, but when I do, I use it asynchronously. Very close. Do you want our knees to touch?
All of us.
No. Oh, me.
That's
no,
right.
This way. Hey, I'm Burke Holland.
And I'm Ben Lesh.
And this is five things about RxJS. Number one, RxJS is a library for composing asynchronous operations in JavaScript. What does that mean?
Well, asynchronous operations in JavaScript are events, and events get triggered by pretty much anything you can imagine that you're doing with a user interface, from mouse movements to button clicks, AJAX calls coming back.
Those are all events.
Yeah, those are all events. And RxJS helps you compose those together. So you can do things like drag and drop, which is mouse down, and then you take all the mouse movements until you mouse up.
So events are hard. RxJS helps make events easier.
Yes, that's right.
Number two, RxJS was invented at Microsoft?
What?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So I work at Google now, and I used to work at Netflix, and I worked on RxJS at both of those places.
But you never worked at Microsoft?
No, I've never worked at Microsoft. I have a Microsoft gym bag.
Really?
Yeah, I do.
I don't have one of those.
But no, it was part of Microsoft's Project Volta. So Project Volta was targeted at compiling C# to JavaScript. And RX.net was very, very popular at the time. So a guy who works at Microsoft named Matt Pavasaki.
Oh, yeah, we know Matt.
Yeah.
Hey, Matt.
Hey, Matt.
He ported it from C# to JavaScript, and that gave us RxJS. And in fact, the logo that RxJS has comes from Microsoft's Project Volta.
What is the logo?
It's like a pink electric eel in kind of a circle.
Oh, shape. Yeah, I've seen it before.
Yeah.
And is Matt on the core? Is he still one of the core maintainers?
So he is still on the core team. He's still one of the core maintainers. Currently, he's focusing most of his work on IXJS, which is it's a kind of a sister library to RxJS. It deals with async iterators.
Can I be on the core
type.
Team?
Sure, if you want
I'm
to contribute.
I'm not on it.
We have lots teams. Of work for you to do.
Okay.
One time I'm at the grocery store, and this kid's just staring at me because I have these spots in my head. And I looked at it, I looked the kid dead in the eye and I said, you see this? This is what happens if you drop out of school. And then the kid's dad was like.
Embarrassingly enough, I went to see if Microsoft's healthcare would cover hair restoration. I'm not above any of this, I'll tell you.
I like it, it's good.
Well, but I have dreams where I have long hair. Number three. RxJS is sometimes referred to as lodash for asynchronous operations. I know what lodash is. How does that apply to asynchronous operations?
Well, RxJS uses this type called observables. And you can think of an observable as a set of events that will happen. When you subscribe to it, you get like a set of events over time. And when you have sets of things, you can apply certain kind of algebras to those sets.
Oh, yeah.
So lodash does this with synchronous sets like arrays or iterators, where you can do things like zip them together or map them and filter them and, you know, kind of chain these different operations together off of these sets that are synchronous sets in lodash. But when you have sets of events, you can do the same thing. And in fact, you can do more things because not only can you map and filter and these other things, but you have another dimension, which is time, because events happen over time.
Right, so then it's not all there at one time. They may show up as time goes on.
Right, so you can do things like you could say combine the latest two values of these things, or maybe you want to throttle or debounce the events or delay them by some amount of time, where you can't necessarily do that with a totally synchronous set. But
Makes sense. Why don't they call it the underscore of asynchronous operations?
I think because underscore kind of lost that fight, it seems like. I mean, maybe there's some underscore fans out there that would be upset with me.
I'm an underscore fan.
But yeah.
I love you, Jeremy.
Number four, a lot of really big companies use RxJS. Companies like Microsoft and Google?
Google, yeah, we're at Google. Google uses a lot of RxJS. Netflix, where I used to work, uses a lot of RxJS. I've heard of them. Facebook, a few people have heard of that.
Haven't heard of them, but whatever you say.
Facebook uses RxJS. Slack, so the desktop client for Slack actually uses RxJS. That's an Electron app, so you can use RxJS in Electron because
it's JavaScript. Using JavaScript on the desktop.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And then I've worked with a lot of other companies too, companies like Groupon and American Express, American Airlines, a few others, Red Hat. I've worked with people from there as well, coaching on RxJS.
So. Wow, so a lot of big companies dealing with a lot of events.
Yes. Events are really big in JavaScript and in computer science in general.
That's right, kids. Learn your events in computer science. I should buy bigger clothes or eat less tacos. And that's not gonna happen.
Or buy bigger clothes and eat more tacos.
I know, that's true. Number five, in order to use RxJS, you have to also use Angular, right?
That's not even remotely true.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Can you double check?
I don't have to. Before I came to Google, I worked at Netflix, and at Netflix I used no Angular, but I used RxJS all over the place.
So I can use RxJS in something like just a plain Node app, deploy that to Azure App Service, and it would just still work?
Absolutely. Yeah, you could write your Node app in 100% RxJS if you really wanted to.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm going to do that directly.
Yep. So at Netflix, we used it with React and Ember and a Node library that I worked on. Facebook uses an Electron app. It's like an Atom editor extension called Nuclide. Another Electron one is Slack. So the Slack client for desktop is all in Electron. And so these are all different environments where RxJS gets used heavily. The Windows client actually for Netflix uses a lot of RxJS.
Oh, so, really?
Yeah.
Interesting. So apparently Ben says you can use it without Angular. If Ben says it, you know it's true.
Yep. Anywhere you like that runs JavaScript, you can try it out. Yeah. Sofa King Hot.
Ah!
That's emoji mastery.
That was amazing. So what's next? How can we find out more about RxJS? How do I learn it?
There's a lot of great resources. So first and foremost, the documentation is a good place to start. That's found at reactivex.io/RxJS. You can also, of course, come find us on GitHub. So that's github.com/reactivex/RxJS. So
there's
lots of
good
stuff there. Yeah, we need all the help we can get. So if people want to show up and contribute, that's fantastic.
I'll be happy to see. I'll make a pull request.
Yeah, please do so. Please do so. The other great resources out there, you can find a lot of courses and stuff on egghead.io, some of which are by me, some of which are by Andre Stoltz and some of the other folks that work on egghead.io. And then also, I actually run a workshop as well that I do for fun. It's a lot of fun. You can find that at rxworkshop.com.
I've heard great things about that workshop.
It's a lot of fun.
Can I get some free tickets?
Yeah, we can probably arrange that.
I mean, we haven't been friends for very long, but
we can arrange it.
I need more RxJS in my life.
Who doesn't?
I know.
Who
absolutely.
Loosen up his voice.
Unique New York. Unique New York. The Human Torch was denied a bank loan.
That's right. The Human Torch was denied a bank loan.
The arsonist has oddly shaped feet.
I'm Ben Lesh.
And I'm Scott Hanselman.
I'm Ben Lesh.
And I'm Burke Holland.
Now you know five things about RxJS.